Amen. Amen. Exalt the Lord our God and worship at his holy hill, for the Lord our God is holy. Amen. Shall we bow our heads? Our dear, kind Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for waking us up this morning to see another beautiful Sabbath day. Lord, we praise you this morning for who you are, for your presence, Lord, in our lives.
Yes, God.
Father, we pray for every precious soul here that will be baptized, Lord, and surrender their lives to you. We pray a special blessing upon them, Lord, that you would keep a hedge of protection around about them. Draw them close to you. Father, bless this service this day. We're so thankful to you for being our God. We thank you for the precious gift of Jesus. Have your way this day in the sanctuary. Speak to each one of our hearts, Father. I pray on this day, keep us and save us. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
So we repeat our affirmation of faith together, found in John 3, verse 16 and 17. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Our affirmation of obedience. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shall thou labor and do all thy work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work, thou, nor thy son, nor thy daughter, nor thy manservant, nor thy maidservant, nor thy cattle, nor thy stranger that is within thy gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that in them is, and rested the seventh day. Wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. Amen. You may be seated.
Morning, church.
Good morning.
Amen.
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 Before,
bless the Lord.
Yeah. Before I get into the call to worship, I just want to thank the church for the prayers and
Amen.
Cards and text messages and phone calls. It has been strengthening and encouraging. Text for the call to worship, Isaiah 41, verse 10.
Yes.
Fear thou not,
that's right.
For I am with thee.
I am with thee.
Yes. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God.
Yes.
Yes, Lord.
I will strengthen thee, yea, I will help thee, yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness.
Oh, yes.
Elisha was in the city of Dothan, and his servant boy woke up and saw the Syrians surrounding the city, have come to take Elisha captive. Well, Elisha said, don't worry about that, because more are with us than are with them. His three Hebrew boys could stand and not bow to the image, irrespective of the outcome, because they recognize that God is with them, that wherever they're going through, that God can be with them and will be with them, irrespective of the outcome.
Yes, sir.
They were not concerned about the outcome, because if not, the fact remains God is with them.
Yes, yes.
Amen.
Daniel can face the lion's den because he wasn't concerned about the outcome. If God delivered, that's fine, but I'm going to face the lion anyway, irregardless of the outcome.
Yes.
God with us. Not necessarily to deliver us, because there's no Christians that are 6,000 years old. At some point in time, we all must perish.
Yes.
All
right.
But the fact remains, as long as God is with us,
yes.
You say, I will be with thee.
Yes.
I will strengthen thee. I will help thee. I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness.
Yes, yes, yes.
Then when faith becomes reality, John said, I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men. He will dwell with them. Faith becomes reality. They shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. I'm looking forward to that day when faith becomes reality. When I hope now and trust in God being with me, but one day he will be with me and be my God, and we'll be his people.
Amen.
Prayer time here at the Straford Church. It's prayer time on this God's holy Sabbath day all over the world.
Yes.
And I want to invite us now, all who are able, and those who are willing, would like to come to the altar, come at this time. And then all who are able, let us bow and kneel before the Lord God Almighty. My Father, my God, as I kneel before you, interceding on behalf of your people, I pray even now for forgiveness and cleansing. And I just want to thank you. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for the opportunity to come before you in prayer.
Yes, God.
Thank you, Heavenly Father, for the confidence that we have in your answering our prayers according to your perfect will.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, Heavenly Father, for being God, the only true, wise, living God. Not the gods that we make up. The ones that are unable to move unless we move them. But the true, only God, the Lord God Almighty. We're looking forward, Heavenly Father, to that day when we can see you face to face. When we can join in the chorus, Heavenly Father, as the angels and the elders and say, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. When we can look at our Savior Jesus and we can truly say, worthy is the Lamb, for he has redeemed us from this world. He has saved us from ourselves. For we have desired, Heavenly Father, to be disobedient to you. We have desired, Heavenly Father, to dwell upon thoughts that we should not, speak words that we shouldn't, take steps in our lives that we shouldn't. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for salvation.
Thank you, Lord.
Through the shed blood of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
And this morning, Heavenly Father, I just ask for forgiveness of this, your people who are called by your name out of darkness into this marvelous light.
Yes.
Forgive us and cleanse us.
Forgive us, Lord.
But then, Heavenly Father, help us to realize that as we have been blessed with the knowledge of your love, your mercy, your faithfulness, your long-suffering, that as your word says, freely have we received, freely should we give.
Yes.
Help us to realize that we have not been saved just to hold on to what we have, but we've been saved to serve.
Yes. Yes.
To share the good news of your son's soon return.
Yes.
Help us each and every one here, each and every household represented here, to redeem the times in which we live in. For soon and very soon, Jesus will come.
Yes, God.
And he will not tarry. Father God, we just want to thank you once again for your goodness, your love, your mercy, your patience towards us. This morning, Heavenly Father, as we look inside our bulletin, we see many names. Pray, Heavenly Father, for Elder Magruder, who had surgery.
Yes, Father.
Pray for Liddy, dear Lord.
Yes.
Pray for Leah's dad,
yes,
who was in his 90s, who was in a car accident.
Yes.
Pray for Elder Roscoe's sister, who has cancer.
Yes.
Pray for Cherry, dear Lord. You know her needs.
Yes.
Pray for Rosie Nelson, Sally Payton,
yes,
Derma Watts, Creasy,
yes,
White,
yes,
Eloise Wagner,
yes,
Sally Davis, Desiree Harris, Joanne Burden,
yes,
Brenda Ledbetter,
yes,
Lamar Lanier, Andre Eccles,
yes,
Carl McGee,
yes,
Mary Richardson, Sister Lee.
Yes.
And then, Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for healing for Elder Bryson.
Yes, yes, yes.
Thank you, Lord.
Then, Heavenly Father, we want to remember these families who are suffering loss.
Yes.
Alexander family, Young family,
yes,
Barrett family,
yes,
Roscoe family, Change family, Abrams,
yes,
family.
Yes.
So many others, dear Lord, that we may not remember. We pray, Heavenly Father, you give them hope in the knowledge of your Son's soon return.
Yes, Lord.
Hope in the day when Jesus shall come through the clouds of glory.
Yes.
Hope, Heavenly Father, in the day when those who are asleep in Christ shall arise,
yes,
to eternal life,
yes,
eternal happiness.
Yes.
No more death, no more suffering, no more crying.
Yes, Lord.
And we just want to thank you for that promise. And we just trust, Heavenly Father, in your faithfulness. Then, Heavenly Father, I pray for those who will be baptized today.
Yes.
Pray for, Heavenly Father, for those who are considering baptism.
Yes, Lord.
Our newly baptized members, do you bind your desire to be saved both here on earth and in heaven?
Yes.
Then I pray, Heavenly Father, for your manservant.
Yes.
Pastor Reed, as he breaks the bread of life to us today. Pray, Heavenly Father, you give him courage, wisdom, a faith, dear Lord, to trust in your faithfulness, trust in your word,
yes,
as he leads your people in these last days.
Yes,
pray,
yes,
for his family and all the leadership of our church.
Yes.
That we, each and every one, each and every member, would take the time to study the scripture for themselves.
Yes.
For the time is coming when we all must stand for ourselves.
Yes.
The pastor won't be there. The elders won't be there. Mom and dad won't be there. Brother and sister won't be there. We must stand for ourselves. Bless us to that end, I do pray. And I just want to thank you once again for all you've done for us. What you're doing even now. And at the time of trouble to come in the future, what you will do for us then. Delivering us. I pray these and many other blessings in the precious name of Jesus, the shepherd and the bishop of our souls. Let everyone say, amen.
Discovered something about myself. I usually ask you all, how many don't you know that, or isn't God good, or can I get in the witness? But today I came to tell you that God is a mighty God.
Yeah.
Is he a mighty God in your life today? Okay, so Today we're going to sing the song. The words are on the screen. Why don't you join in with us as a testimony to your neighbors, to your friends, that God is a mighty God, that he opens doors for you, that he makes a way out of no way, that he leads you where you didn't think you could go. I let testify this morning where he opens doors that you don't even see. So he is a
mighty God.
He is a
mighty God.
He is a
mighty God.
Yes, he is. Put your hands together. Come on.
Volume on my microphone here today. How many believe the Lord is a mighty God? Amen. Amen. He is a mighty God. Amen. He is alive and well, and it's because of his grace, because of his mercy, why we're here today. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Just a little more. I'll even turn the monitors on for me. Thank you. How's everyone doing on this Sabbath? Happy Sabbath to you. Amen. Amen. On last week, we were blessed to have Pastor William Joseph. He shared with us throughout the weekend. And we praise God for his ministry here on last weekend. I would also like to let you all know that I did not pay him to come here last week to say all of those wonderful things that he said about me. I want you to know I didn't bring him for that reason. And I was wondering who he was talking about while I was sitting there. But I want you to know that I know that he mentioned, and you know, I said this at prayer meeting, I know he mentioned that they were considering my wife and myself, but I want you to know my wife and I take very seriously the direction of God leading Amen. Our lives. Amen. And at this point, God has not given us any indication that he wants us to move from the Straford Memorial Church. And so I want you to know that even if an offer is extended, God is ultimately going to have to tell us what he wants us to do. Amen. Amen. And so we love you. We're glad to be here. And until the Lord says otherwise, we'll be here until then. Amen. Amen. Also, I know I don't want anyone here to feel any pressure about Pastoral Appreciation Month at all. I really do mean that from the bottom of my heart. I'm happy when you all are at prayer meeting, like I tell the prayer meeting crowd. My heart is glad when I see you all growing and maturing in Jesus Christ and loving one another in his name. And that's all I need. That's all the thanks I need. Amen. Amen. So I just want you to know that. Feel no pressure. And ultimately, the person's opinion that I care the most about is God, because only he will be able to judge my work as to whether or not I have been faithful to what he has called me. So I love you and I appreciate all of everything that you do. But please, I want you all to know, please feel no pressure. Amen. 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 I just want to take the time just to remember. We want to remember a couple of individuals. Many of you may know, may not have known, but Elder Magruder recently had a major surgery, had the opportunity to see him. He's doing well, and I understand now he's actually in Texas. So it seems that they have released him, and he seems to be recovering well. And so let's just continue to lift him up in prayer. I see his son and his daughter-in-law here today. So we just want to let your dad, please let your dad know that we're continuing to pray for him. We also, as you heard mentioned in the prayer today, Sister Leah Jowers, her father was involved in an accident and they're having emergency surgery. He's 90 years old. And so she's rushing 99. Wow, I didn't know that. So let's keep him lifted up in our prayers and her as well as they travel along the highways. We also want to remember Brother Lidwin Ramsey. Many of you know he's still recovering from major surgery. I want to also take the time just to welcome back with us Elder Arthur Bryson. I know he came to us early, but it's so good to see him back with us on today. Amen. And so we pray that God will continue to work his healing touch in his life and on his body. Amen. Amen. Also see Sister Marie Richardson here today. Amen. Amen. It's so good to see you, Sister Richardson. I'm also here. We have with us a longtime member, Sister Juanita Johnson. Amen. Some of you all know who she is. There she is. All right. Good to see you. Good to meet you today. And we have quite a few visitors. I believe we have, I'm going to say this right, the Gathing family here today. Is that I said that right, Sister Green? All right. The Gathing. They're here for a baby blessing. And so we also just want to welcome them as well. As many of you know, today is a baptism. Amen. And it's amen. Praise the Lord. You know, the Bible tells us that there is rejoicing in heaven over one sinner that comes to repentance. Amen. And so we praise God for the candidates that are here today and just, you know, our Bible worker team, Sister Bryson, the leadership of Sister Bryson, the work that they do with Bible studies. We actually had some other individuals scheduled to be baptized on today. A lady by the name of Elizabeth, her son was had to have surgery on yesterday. I believe it was yesterday and I'm unable to be here on today. Then another individual was unable to be here as well. And so we just want to, I just want to pause this. We want to say a special prayer for Sister Elizabeth's son and just for God to be with them. Because we know while these are serious things that are happening, the enemy wants to create opportunities for them not to experience the life of Jesus Christ. And so we want to pray for them today and pray against his work in his life. Father in heaven, Lord, we just want to thank you for those who have responded to your voice to give their hearts completely to you. Lord, I pray today that when they go down into the watery grave of baptism, that they would experience all of the fullness of who you are. Lord, we want to remember those who are unable to be here today. Sister Elizabeth, her son who is in the hospital recovering from major surgery. Oh, Lord, I pray that you would be with him. Oh, God, I pray that you would give him strength, that you would give him complete and total healing. Lord, we also want to pray for her. Lord, I pray that the seed that you have sown in her heart today that has caused her to want to be baptized, that it will bear fruit, that she will indeed come and be baptized. We also want to pray for Sister Little, who was not here today. Lord, you have been leading her on an awesome journey in relationship with you. And so, Lord, we pray that even now, oh Lord, that you would make a way for her to walk through these doors on today and be baptized. But if not, oh God, we pray that if it's not today, that it will be soon. Be with her now, wherever she is. Fill her with your love. Surround her with your presence. In Jesus' name, let everyone say amen. Amen. We also want to welcome Brother George Reed, who was the family member of Novelette and Brother and Sister Clark, Norman Clark. He's here all the way from Canada. You're going to hear from him today. He's a minister of music at his church, and he's going to bless us with a song a little bit later here in our service. Amen. Amen. And so we're looking forward to that. So glad to have you. Apparently he has the same last name spelled the same way. So we don't know. Maybe we might be related. Amen. many of you know on next Sabbath evening, there's a preseason game. One of our senior basketball teams, Joel Middleton, the coach of that team, will be playing the Suns. We're also going to be having a game and fun night. We're going to be having the pastor, myself, I'm actually going to play. Even though I said I retired. But I'm going to play along with some elders and deacons. We're going to play the Pathfinders, who have been talking a lot of trash out here. Now, they're not here today, so I can talk a little bit more. They went to Bethlehem French. You know, I played Allende about 5 years ago. He was 10, and I it wasn't close, but it was close enough. I really don't want to play him again. You know, he's he's a lot taller and stronger, but I think we'll be able to handle them. Amen. I hope so. Amen on next week. So if you want to come out, that's going to be a treat. We're looking forward to that on next Sabbath evening. Also, we want to recognize the McElroys celebrated 21 years of marriage together. Amen. Awesome. Awesome. Amen. Amen. What an awesome testimony. Amen. Of married life. And I do have one more thing that I need to share with you. Our new president of the Lake Region Conference has sent out a letter that he wants to be read to all of our churches. And so I'm just going to be obedient to what he has asked for us to do. And it's a couple paragraphs. I'll try to read it quickly here. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, warmest Christian greetings. 70 years ago on September 26, 1944, to be exact, a group of intrepid men and women met at the Shiloh SDA Church in Chicago and voted into existence the Lake Region Conference of Seventh-day Adventists. As envisioned by the group, the new conference would have as its main mission the evangelization of African Americans in the Lake Union Conference territory, thus hastening the second coming of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. During its 70-year of existence, the Lake Region Conference wishes to pause to commemorate, if not celebrate, its ongoing story of mission and ministry, to recommit itself to the founding ideals of its pioneers, and to renew its pledge to expend its energies and extend itself so as to win the lost for Christ. To that end, a committee consisting of individuals from around the conference has been impaneled to plan a series of events to commemorate the founding of the Lake Region Conference, chaired by Dr. Helen Bryan of the City Temple Church in Detroit, Michigan. The committee wishes to launch the commemoration with a special service of prayer and thanksgiving on the 70th anniversary of the date of the vote to establish the conference Friday, September 26, 2014. That's this coming Friday. The service, which will take place at the Shiloh SDA Church in Chicago, will be streamed live so that those who are unable to be present in person may still experience it. In fact, Churches around the conference are encouraged to open their doors and download the service, giving their members the opportunity to participate in the service. Please know that during the year, other events will occur around and throughout the conference, and a capstone event will take place at Camp Meeting 2015. Thank you in advance for planning to support the events being choreographed to commemorate and celebrate the Lake Region story. The goal of the celebration is renewal and re-engagement and recommitment and revitalization. Moving forward with renewed purpose and fervor is our aim and goal. We look forward to seeing you at Shiloh on the evening of Friday, September 26th, as our year-long commemoration celebration is launched. The service will run from 7 to 8:30 p.m. in him, R. Clifford Jones, Pastor President. And so I just wanted to communicate that to you on behalf of the Lake Region Conference and Dr. Clifford Jones. At this time, I would like to welcome anyone who is visiting with us, perhaps for the first time. We just want to invite you to stand. We just want to acknowledge your presence here today. We're not going to make you say anything. Don't worry. We just want to stand so we can see who you are as we prepare to greet one another, that we can make sure that we greet you on today. Amen. 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 Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. And so at this time, I want us to join together, get up and greet each other as we sing our welcome song, as we greet each other with a smile and a hug on today. Amen. 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 Amen, amen. If we can make our way back to our seats at this time as we prepare for make our way back to our seats, please.
Good morning. Happy Sabbath. The Prison Ministry Awards Dinner will be held on Sunday, October 26th. Pastor Wesley Knight will be the speaker. See Elder Fisher or Sister Powell for your tickets. Cooking to the Glory of God, Health and Cooking School with Chef Calvin Howell will meet from Meat Ministry will be held on October 5th, 7th, 9th, and the 12th. Registration is now open and space is limited. It costs $30 a person and it includes cookbooks, handouts, and meals. For questions or to RSVP, contact Denise Robinson. If you want a form, please raise your hand and an usher will bring you one. Let's Move Day this Sunday. We will meet at 63rd Street Beach parking lot and walk along the lakefront for a 3K or 5K walk, jog, run, skate, or bike. We'll be there from 8:30 to 11 a.m. Walking starts at 9 o'clock. Water and refreshments given out after the walk and parking is free. We have a thank you letter. When I count my blessings, I always think of you. To my brothers and sisters in Christ, Pastor Reed and family, I would like to say thanks to each and every one that came out last weekend to celebrate and fellowship Senior's Day and my birthday. May God's grace and mercy fill your hearts with love, joy, and peace always. Cause I couldn't be more grateful for the thoughtful things you do. Sister Iola Lane Ghostin. Sometimes God's blessings are not in what he gives, but in what he takes away. God knows all, God always knows best. Just trust him. Have a happy Sabbath. Amen.
Amen. One thing as we prepare, we're getting ready to do a baby blessing. But just before we do that, I was corrected that Brother Magruder apparently is still here in Richton Park. So I don't know where that information came from, but he is still in Richton Park. So please keep him in prayer. This time we have a very special, as always, all baby blessings are special. And so we want to invite the parents and the family of Jamila Preston, if they would come now and join us here on the platform as we prepare to dedicate their lovely little girl back to the Lord today. Amen. Stand in the middle, and if you guys could just come and just flank them on the left and on the right, just gather in. Thank you. Some of you can come on this side if you'd like. So we're gonna, Sister Truss is gonna introduce the family. Have a special song.
Happy Sabbath, everyone.
Happy Sabbath.
We have Jamila Preston. She was born May 5th, 2014, to Jermaine Preston and Nefertiti Kathy Queen, as we know her. Anita, where's she at? The grandma.
Grandma's right here.
Grandma. I'm your grandmother.
Did you want to introduce me? it's called Cherish This Time. So your baby is here. What joy, what pleasure. Now your life is expanding to make room for this treasure. A darling newcomer to have and to hold. Her smiles are more precious than silver or gold. She'll demolish your schedule, though she's helpless and small. She'll make her needs known, and she'll rule over all. See, a new parent's work is just never quite done, but you'll never mind, because it's all so much fun. When you hear her cute giggle, you'll start awing and ooing, and she'll soon reply back by gaga and goo-gooing. Those big innocent eyes see a world strange and new. To make sense of it all, she'll look only to you. So cherish this time of miraculous things, the excitement and wonder that a new baby brings. Amen. Now, Kermie, he has a dedication.
All right, Kermie, come on now.
Muscles.
Lord, I come to you. I ask you to grant my request. The prayer I pray today is different than the rest. The enemy is threatened by the gift you gave to me. My earnest prayer, cover me.
Yes, yes, yes.
Jesus, say a prayer for me.
Yes, yes,
yes,
yes.
You know what I need.
Yes.
Go before the Father and intercede. But like you did for Peter,
yes.
Say a prayer for me.
Yes, 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 yes.
For those that you called, you fully equipped,
yes,
to fight the wind and the rain. To captain the ship, but I don't mind the storm. I'm willing to sail.
Yeah.
God, cover me that my faith won't fail. Jesus, say a prayer for me.
Yes.
You know what I need. Go before the Father and intercede for me. The enemy desires to sift me as wheat, but like you did for Peter, say a prayer. Like you did for Peter, say a prayer. Like you did for Peter, say a prayer for me.
Amen.
Amen. What a beautiful song. Amen. What a fitting song.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen. You know, Jesus says, suffer the little children to come unto me and forbid them not, for such is the kingdom of heaven. When Jesus says those words, it was at the height of his popularity. Everybody was rushing towards him, wanting to get a glimpse, wanting to be touched by Jesus. And some of the mothers standing by decided that they wanted to bring their child to Jesus so that he could touch them.
That's right.
It's interesting, the word also conveys to light a fire, to ignite something. And so I think I want to suggest that they wanted Jesus to ignite something in their little child's heart that only Jesus could do. And so they bring their child to Jesus, but the disciples, thinking they're acting in Jesus' behalf, decide to stop them. But Jesus says, no, let them come. And really, they thought the children weren't important enough to come to Jesus. But Jesus says, this is the kingdom of heaven. He says, really, they embody what it means to be a follower of Jesus Christ. And what Jesus is saying is that they're young, they're impressionable, they're teachable. You can pour into them. They're receptive. They're willing. And so because of that, Jesus says, let them come to me. But it also suggests that there's great responsibility when it comes to bringing a child to Jesus because they're so impressionable. And Jesus takes it so seriously that he says, it'd be better for a millstone to be tied around your neck and for you to be drowned in the bottom of a sea than for you to cause one of these little ones to fall. That's how precious Jamila is to Jesus. And I believe that you have brought her here today because you want her to be blessed, to be touched, for God to ignite something in her heart. But not only will God do his part, but you have a part to play. Because you must now fan the flame that Jesus ignites in her heart. For the Bible says that God has placed eternity in all of our hearts, inside of Jamila's heart, a longing for him, to live with him for eternity. And she has been given to you so that you can nurture her and fan that flame. And in order for that flame to be fanned, you must also know the Jesus, the one who planted the flame. You see, it's not enough for her to grow up and be a great person and go down in history books. None of that will matter if she doesn't know Jesus. And that is what God has called the two of you to, and everybody here, to fan the flame in Jamila's heart so that on that great day, when he comes back, he'll be ready to receive her because she knows him. And so God has called you. And it's interesting, they wanted her to be touched, the child to be touched, but then Jesus blesses the child. Blessing is to ask divine favor on the child. And who better to bring about divine favor on a child than Jesus himself? And so today, we're going to pray for her that God will pour out all his divine blessings and favor on her life so that she will be filled with all of the fullness of him. Amen. Amen. And so we know you can't do it alone. That's why your family is here. That's why your church family is here. Because we understand, like the old African proverb said, it takes a village to raise a child. And we're here to support you. We're here to give you all the support we can as you lead her to love and honor God. And so today, before all these witnesses today, do you covenant with God to do everything you can to help her to know and love Jesus Christ? Do you? Amen. I'm going to say a prayer. The elders, if we can come a little bit closer and perhaps... Father in heaven, Lord, we just want to thank you for this special gift that you have given Nefertiti and our dear brother Preston here. Lord, you knew way back in time, even before time began, that Jamila would be their daughter and that they would be here today offering her back to you. And so, Lord, I pray, oh God, that you would touch little Jamila's life. Lord, that you would pour out your divine blessings upon her. Lord, I pray that when she comes to the age of accountability, when she comes to that place where she hears your voice speaking to her, Lord, I pray that she would respond in faith. May she be all that you have called her to be. May she spread your divine influence throughout the entire world in this wicked generation. Lord, I pray that you put a hedge of protection around her. Lord, I pray that you would surround her with holy angels, that the enemy will not be able to take her off of the path. Lord, I pray for her parents, oh God. May they see the weight of this responsibility, and may they decide in their hearts to consecrate themselves to you so that they can pour into Jamila. Lord, I pray that you would bless them, that you would give them wisdom. For Lord, you are the beginning of wisdom. And Lord, may they come to you and know that they can find all that they need in you. And Lord, we pray for the family, the grandparents, the aunts, the uncles, and the friends that are here standing in support. Lord, strengthen their hands. May they be there for them as well. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And on behalf of the family life here at Straford Church and the church family as a whole, we have baby's first Bible.
Amen.
Then we have three books for you. The Ministry of Healing.
All right.
It has a chapter in there on parenting.
Amen.
And the child. Then we have a book entitled Happiness, Keys to Happiness, Successful Parenting. Then we have another book. It's entitled The Great Hope. Because when it's all said and done, as the pastor said, it's all about little Jamila getting to heaven. But we want the parents first to have that desire to get to heaven. Amen. God bless you. And continue praying together. Have a worship time. Pray together as a family. Start your morning together with prayer. End your day with prayer. Amen. And God will continue to guide you. God bless you.
Amen. God bless you. Is there? Okay. Well, we pray. We were praying for you. God bless all of you. Bless you as you continue. Enjoy the rest of the worship service and as you continue to raise Jamila. Amen. Let's give him a round of applause, everybody. Amen. God bless you. You may return to your seats at this time.
Today is our children are going to collect an offering, and then they're going to go downstairs for children's church. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So, okay, the adults, you should be reaching in pockets and purses. Can all the babies make their way back? Oh, somebody way in the back. go way back over there in the corner. Okay, can all the children come back up here for a second, please? Cheyenne, can you direct the children downstairs? Can you be the leader and take them downstairs? Okay, so Cheyenne is going to lead you all, so you all follow her in a straight line. Hold on, Cheyenne hasn't left yet. Can you take them down? Go through that door right there. Cheyenne's the leader. Follow Cheyenne. Thank you. Follow Cheyenne. Thank you all so much for your generosity. Our guest from Canada, Mr. Reed. Good morning. Happy Sabbath. Welcome to Straford. Can we give him a warm Straford welcome?
I think it's afternoon. Good afternoon, church. It's a privilege for my wife and myself to be visiting here today and to share within your worship. You see, there are a lot of us, sometimes we go on vacation and we stay home. We don't mingle among the brethren. You know, we and when you ask them, where did you go? And they tell you, I went to Chicago. Did you get time to go to church? He says, no, we slept in. But I'm so happy that my wife and I, could you please stand, Carmen, could you please stand, please? That's my wife. Amen. That's my wife, Carmen. Yeah, so we are privileged to be here to worship with Amen. You today. Amen. And to be a part of God's family, the Remnant Church.
Ooh, let us be a generation of reconciliation and peace, and let us be a holy nation where pride and prejudice shall cease. Let us speak the truth in love to the lost and least of these. Let us serve the Lord with unity, so others would believe. Let us be the generation of reconciliation and peace. Oh yes. Oh, let us be the generation of reconciliation and peace. And let us build on one foundation till he comes and the wars of men shall cease. Let us share the love of Jesus without hypocrisy. Let mercy and forgiveness begin with you and me. Let us be the generation of reconciliation and peace. Oh, yes. Father. Oh, have we not one faith? Have we not one calling to become one holy race? Yeah. Let us be the generation of reconciliation in peace.
Let us pray
restoration.
Seek the Lord together on our knees.
Oh, let us keep our hearts from evil and cling to what is good. Let us honor one another and love to the brotherhood. Oh yes, reconciliation in peace. Let us be the generation of reconciliation in peace.
I'd like to say thank you very much, and to our pastor. Pastor, I know you know Basil Reed. Pastor Basil Reed said to me, once you are a Reed, you're always a Reed.
Good afternoon and happy Sabbath, Straford. We have two precious souls this morning for baptism, amen. And that's what we're all about here at Straford, is baptism. I am mindful of how Satan works. I see his hand, and I don't want to give him any more power than he thinks he has. But we had two more candidates who Satan affected their children, not them, but he affected their children so that they couldn't be here today. So we want to keep them in prayer. When our people come down for and they say they want to be baptized, rebaptized, whatever, we need to start keeping them in prayer at that moment, because yeah. Satan is definitely busy. Yeah. So we're going to have Keena Prince and Sean Essex Loa. Could you stand?
Will you come forward? Man, I actually want you to face the congregation. I want you to listen to me, but I want you to face the congregation. We will now administer the baptismal vows. Amen. And just like a marriage, I want you to say, I do.
All right.
In response. Do you believe there is one God, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, a unity of three co-eternal persons? I do.
I do.
Do you accept the death of Jesus Christ on Calvary as the atoning sacrifice for your sins and believe that by God's grace through faith in his shed blood, you are saved from sin and its penalty? Do you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and personal Savior, believing that God in Christ has forgiven your sins and given you a new heart, and do you renounce the sinful ways of the world? Do you accept by faith the righteousness of Christ, your intercessor in the heavenly sanctuary, and accept his promise of transforming grace and power to live a loving Christ-centered life in your home and before the world?
Amen.
Do you believe that the Bible is God's inspired word, the only rule of faith and practice for the Christian? Do you covenant to spend time regularly in prayer and Bible study? Do you accept the Ten Commandments as the transcript of the character of God and a revelation of his will? Is it your purpose by the power of the indwelling Christ to keep this law, including the fourth commandment, which requires the observance of the seventh day of the week as the Sabbath of the Lord and the memorial of his creation? Amen. Do you look forward to the soon coming of Jesus and the blessed hope when this mortal shall put on immortality? As you prepare to meet the Lord, will you witness to his loving salvation by using your talents in personal soul-winning endeavor to help others to be ready for his glorious appearing? Do you accept the biblical teaching of spiritual gifts and believe that the gift of prophecy is one of the identifying marks of the remnant church? Do you believe in church organization? Is it your purpose to worship God and to support the church through your tithes and offering and by your personal effort and influence? Do you believe that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit? And will you honor God by caring for it, avoiding the use of that which is harmful, abstaining from all unclean foods, from the use, manufacture, or sale of alcoholic beverages, the use, manufacture, or sale of tobacco in any of its forms for human consumption, and from the misuse of or trafficking in narcotics or other drugs? Do you know and understand the fundamental Bible principles as taught by the Seventh-day Adventist Church? Do you purpose, by the grace of God, to fulfill his will by ordering your life in harmony with its principles? Do you accept the New Testament teaching of baptism by immersion and desire to be baptized as a public expression of faith in Christ and his forgiveness of your sins? Do you accept and believe that the Seventh-day Adventist Church is the remnant church of Bible prophecy, and that people of every nation, race, and language are invited and accepted into his fellowship? Do you desire to be a member of this local congregation of the world's church? Church, you have heard the affirmation of the baptismal vows. What is your pleasure? It has been moved and seconded. Any opposition need not be present. Let's take them to the water.
Amen. First, we're going to have Keena Prince to be baptized. Amen. Family and friends, if you want to gather around, you are more than welcome. Amen.
Christ, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit. Be thou faithful unto death.
Amen. 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 Come on, Sean. Come on, sweetie, so you can watch. Next, we have Chantella Essex-Lawa to be baptized. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
family and friends.
Sean, because of your desire to recommit yourself to God and your desire to live with Him throughout your entire life, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit. Be thou faithful unto death.
Amen.
Some of us sitting out there, we want to live a victorious life. We don't know how to do it. Well, give your heart to Jesus.
Yes.
He will fill you with the power to do it.
Yes.
And so maybe you don't need to hear a sermon today. Maybe right now you're ready to give your heart to Him.
All
right. So we want to give you an opportunity to wave your hand wherever you are.
Yeah.
Wherever you are, if God has moved and spoke to you in this baptismal service thus far today, and you want to give your heart to Him and be baptized, we want to invite you to wave your hand wherever you are. Now we'll have another appeal at the end. We'll still have time. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
God bless you. Just continue with our worship service.
Amen.
Let us prepare our hearts for the scriptures as found in Ephesians, 4th chapter.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
I shall read in your hearing verses 1 through 4. Ephesians, the 4th chapter, 1 through 4 in your hearing. If you have it, say amen.
Amen.
Let us stand for scripture. I, therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that ye walk worthy of the vocation wherewith you are called, with all lowliness and meekness, with long suffering, forbearing one another, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, even as ye are called in one hope of your calling. May the Lord add a rich blessing to the hearing and the doing of His holy word. You may be seated.
This is the time to return unto the Lord, our tithes and our offering. May the deacons please come for prayer. Father, every good gift comes from you. Yes. You give generously without refusing or reproaching anyone. May our gift, Lord, assist in the preaching of the gospel so that men may be saved in your kingdom. Amen.
Come on, church. Can't nobody do me like Jesus.
Do me like Jesus.
Can't nobody do me like the Lord.
Do me like the Lord.
Oh, can't nobody
do me like Jesus.
He's my friend.
He's my friend.
Let's sing that one more time. Come on, Chuck. Can't nobody do me like Jesus. Oh, can't like the Lord. Oh, can't
nobody
do me like Jesus.
He's my friend.
Pick me up and turn me around.
Run on.
Heal my body.
Told me.
Told me.
Run on.
Amen. Do you worship and do you adore? Somebody need to be throwing their hands up about now. Oh Lord, we worship and adore your name.
You got it out,
oh Lord.
Up this morning. Get out of your bed.
All right, all right.
In the first place, you didn't wake yourself up.
That's right, that's right.
But the Lord Himself touched you. Amen. Katie, with His sweet finger.
Hallelujah, God.
Of love.
Thank you, Lord.
Just a finger. He didn't even need His whole hand to do that work. But He looked down and He saw His children and He said, today, somebody is going to gather together to worship me, to bless me, to praise me, to give me honor. And then someone is going to open up their mouth and say, oh Lord, I worship. Because sometimes we have to make that thing personal. I worship and I adore your name. Come on, lift your voices. Oh Lord, we worship and adore your name. Listen, don't even worry that it's me standing up here. because I don't have any place to put you. It's not me that's going to be coming back to receive you unto myself. Sometimes I think that I'm big and bad, but I'm not big and bad enough to do that. Only our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ. He says, reconciling the world unto himself. Amen. That's why we can lift our hands and we can lift our voices and we can lift our hearts and our spirits and just say unto him, come on one more time. Oh Lord, we worship. Oh Lord. And adore your name.
And adore your name.
Come on, Monte. Oh, Lord.
Oh, Lord. We worship and adore your name.
And adore you. Just want to tell you, Lord, I love you. Lord, I love you more than anything. Oh, come on, lift your voices together. I love you, Jesus.
I love you, Jesus.
Just put yourself in a place of worship.
I worship and adore you.
Just want to tell you.
Just want to tell you.
Lord, I love you.
Lord, I love you more than anything.
Come on, let's say, I love you, Jesus.
Tell you, Lord, I love you more than anything.
purpose and joy comes in the morning.
Amen. Amen.
Troubles, they don't last always. Come on, somebody else know it, just come on up. For there's a friend named Jesus. You know what he can do, Pat?
Yes, Lord.
He can wipe away.
Yes, Lord.
Ask him to wipe. I know it
because
he's done it for me.
Yes.
And if your heart, just lift your hands.
Yes.
Yes.
And then it says, I know.
Yes.
That's a statement.
Yeah.
That I can make it.
I know that I can stand.
You took the stand.
I know.
No matter what, may come my way.
My heart.
My life.
Your hand.
Come on, you don't have to worry.
You don't have to worry.
And don't you be afraid.
Joy comes in the morning.
Troubles, they don't last always.
For there's a friend in Jesus.
Who will wipe your tears away.
And if your heart is broken.
Just lift your hands and say,
I know that I can make it.
I know that I can stand. No matter what may come my way.
Testimony. Oh, I know.
Thank you, Jesus.
Let's bow our heads. Lord, truly you are in this place today. And it is so good to know that we belong to you. And that ultimately our lives are in your hands. So, Lord, we thank you for holding us and keeping us. And so, Lord, as we prepare to open your word today, I pray that you would prepare our hearts, that we would be receptive to what you have for us. May we grow today in a knowledge of who you are. In Jesus' name, amen. Man, I want to begin with defining the word genuine. And many of you could probably think of a few definitions right off bat. But the word genuine means truly what something is said to be, authentic, free from hypocrisy or pretense, sincere. Now, the opposite meaning of that word would be what some might say, phony. You so phony. The word there, the dictionary definition is not true, real, or genuine. Intended to make someone think something that is not true. In our culture today, making a false show is another definition, making a false show. In our culture today, we pride ourselves on having people or knowing people or people being what we call genuine. One of the major mantras of the day is keeping it real. I'm just keeping it real. Many of us have probably said that a number of times. I'm just keeping it real with you. And many of you know this guy, Steve Harvey, is probably one of the people that has helped made this phrase even more popular, because his whole idea, I'm going to tell you like it is. I'm going to tell you the truth about whatever it is, whether it's dating, how to be successful, how to think like a man. I'm going to keep it real for you. Now, probably our generation, the younger generation, probably saying Ray J's phrase, keeping it 100. That's another way of saying keeping it real. And I guess if I was to be true to how he says it's keeping it 100. That's how you're supposed to say it. All right, 100. I can say it. I know I'm saying 100. I know that's not how Ray J says it. All right, keeping it real, right? We see that that's a very important thing in our culture today. Even the show, some of you watch a show called Catfish. Some of you younger people probably know about this, where people have fake online identities. You know, they have a picture of themselves on Facebook and on Twitter that looks nothing, absolutely nothing like them. It's not even their real face, right? And so people end up getting in relationships for 3, 4, 5 years, and they're in love before they finally meet each other. And then when they come out in the real, most of those relationships do not last. They actually break up instantly because they often look nothing like they say they look. So it's interesting, you know, and we live in a world where you can be whoever you want to be on Facebook or Twitter. You can have a whole nother life that's not really real. But in our culture, that's very important. Another, you know, this has been discussed recently and it's kind of blossomed, but Ray Rice, many of you know him and, you know, what's gone down with him. And for him, many people looked at him as a high character guy. You know, he was a man that worked in the community. And so when this happened, it was not reflective of who he had made himself out to be, all right? So he wasn't authentic in that sense. But if you think about today, what are some of the reasons why people don't come to church? Because they say normally they're just a bunch of hypocrites in there. All right, so we see a culture that is valuing authenticity, real people, and then they look to the church and they feel that there aren't any real Christians in the church. They're hypocrites. You know, some of you know this guy, Gandhi, and he made a couple quotes. One, he says, "I like your Christ, I do not like your Christians. Your Christians are so unlike your Christ."
Paraphrase, he says, I believe in the teachings of Christianity and I would join, but I've yet to see a Christian who practices all that they teach. By the way, the title of my sermon today is Walk Worthy, How to Walk Worthy. Amen. And so really what he's saying and really what the world is saying is that they're looking for real, authentic people who act in the way they say that they believe or in accordance with the person in whom they say that they're following and whom they believe in. And so I want to ask a couple questions, not for you to answer, but rhetorically to think about as we move into the word today. But what is a key indicator that reveals whether or not an individual has truly been transformed by the life of Christ and that they are indeed genuine followers of him? How do you know? What are the indicators? And why is it so important for Christians to be who they say they are?
Hmm?
And today I believe God's word is going to help us to understand and answer these questions. I want to go with our scripture text today. If you have your Bibles, turn with me there. Or if you want to read along with us on the screen, this is the New King James Version.
Amen.
Ephesians chapter 4, verses 1 to 6. And Paul says, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you to walk worthy of the calling with which you were called. With all lowliness and gentleness, with long suffering, bearing with one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. Walk worthy. And it's interesting. We must pay attention to the word that Paul uses there as he starts. He uses the word therefore, which is a significant word. It's a, those of you who are into the words in English, you understand that that word therefore is predicated on what came before that. And so Paul begins by saying therefore. In the immediate context, if you look at the verse right at the end of chapter 3 in verse 20, he says, now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us. So Paul is saying, therefore, according to him who's able to do beyond anything we could imagine, according to the power that works in us, I beseech you to now walk worthy. Are you guys with me today? I want you to stay with me now. And so he says, what is the power? The question is, what is the power that works in us? And really we understand the power that works in us, according to Ephesians, is the Holy Spirit, the very life of God living inside of us. And so we must understand something, that God comes up with the plan of salvation, Jesus accomplishes it, but then he gives the Holy Spirit to make it real and experiential in our lives. He is the one, essentially now, that keeps us in Christ Jesus, that causes us to live a holy life according to the power that works in us. Now, that's the immediate context, and we're going to unpack that a little bit more, but we must also understand the broader context in which Paul is talking about. Because remember now, we've been going through chapters 1, 2, 3, and if we look at what he's saying, first of all, therefore, because God has accomplished everything in Christ Jesus. Every spiritual blessing in heavenly places. Therefore, because you have been moved from death to life. Therefore, because you have been raised and seated with Christ in heavenly places. Therefore, we are a new humanity in Christ, united in him. Therefore, since you have been filled with all of the fullness of God, which he's talking about the Holy Spirit, then he's saying, now walk worthy. I want you to understand something. This is important for us to even begin to understand what Paul is trying to say to us. And so it is interesting now. In chapters 1 through 3, he's been talking about who we are. He's been talking about being. He has been trying to emphasize that what is essential in order for us to walk as Christians the way that God intended for us to be, he had to first deal with the very essence of who we are as believers in Jesus Christ. But now he makes a transition. He goes to chapter 4, and here his emphasis is now on doing.
Amen.
how we now live in light of everything that God has done for us in Christ Jesus. And so he says that you have been sealed in chapter 1, verse 13. You were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. And we must understand something. That is the Holy Spirit living in us that causes us to live a life that is worthy of the calling that God has called us to. Are y'all with me today? All right, so I want you to understand something. Therefore, which really what Paul has been doing in all of Ephesians, he has been sowing the word inside of their hearts, the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so we understand that Jesus says in Mark chapter 4 that the sower went out, talking about himself, and he sows the seed, which is the word of God. And so the soil is the heart of the believer. Hear me now, stay with me. And what Jesus is saying is that the ability of the seed, the word to grow, in the life of the believer depends on the type of soil that it falls into. In other words, what type of heart you have is what creates the climate and the condition for God's word to be able to be released inside of your life so that his power can have full and complete and total control of the life of the believer. Are you all with me today? And it's interesting, when he talks about the word, he's not just talking, I said here, the word of Christ, because Jesus says, these are they which testify of me. He says, you search the scriptures because in them you think you have eternal life, but these are they that testify of me. And so what Jesus is saying is that my word is not just a rule book. It's not just a manual. It's not just a list of expectations, but they are about me. They reveal who I am. And so in order for Christ to be released in the life of the believer, the word of God must fall inside a heart that is receptive to his word. And in Mark chapter 4, he really talks about different categories of kind of hearts, the stony heart, the thorny heart. And here he says in Mark 4, verse 20, he says, but these are the ones sown on good ground, those who hear the word, accept it, and bear fruit. Stay with me now. So it's not enough just to hear the word. It's not enough just to say amen, hallelujah, I know it's true. But he says you must also accept it. In other words, you must receive it in your heart. You must say, not only do I hear it, but I want to live it. And he says that when it is heard and when it is received, then the fruit is able, the word of God is able to bear fruit in the life of the believer when these conditions are met. Hear me now. You want to know how to grow spiritually? You want God's power to be released in your life? Hear the word, receive it, decide that you're going to live by it, and then God is able to cause you to live a life that is pleasing unto him. Amen. He says in verse 20, now to him who is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us. The power is released in the word of God when it's received by the believer. Let me try to illustrate this for you. So, for example, God now plants his word in the heart of the believer. He puts his seed inside of our hearts. And when it is received, then God's power is completely released inside of us so that he now fills us completely with all of the fullness, all of who he is, so that we can now begin to live a life that is holy and pleasing unto him. What is interesting, and here Jesus is talking about another way of illustrating, we see here a seed, the stages of a plant, and we see the seed first goes down into the ground, and then it begins to, when it breaks open, it begins to now start having roots that go down deep into the soil. And the more the tree grows, the deeper the roots. And really what Paul is saying here in Ephesians, he's trying to show us how to grow spiritually. And he says the more that we are living according to God's word, the more that we are receiving all that he has to say, it is the deeper our roots are. It's the more grounded that we are in him. It's the more unmovable that we are. The more unshakable that we are. The more that we receive him, God is able to release his power inside of us. And there's no other way for his power to be released unless the gospel, the word, is taught clearly and with the power of the Holy Spirit. And then when we receive it, then God releases his power. And then we're able to live according to the power that works in us. So it's not for us now to stir up the power to live right. It is now to rely on the power that has been released inside of us in order to live right. So the plant grows not because it's trying to grow. It's growing because a power has been released inside of it. Oh, y'all not with me today. I believe the enemy don't want y'all to receive this word today. I believe it. I'm not just saying that. This is the secret to spiritual growth in the life of the believer. This is the difference between life in Christ than legalism or moralism. Paul says, in order to grow, God's power must be received and released in the life of the believer. And you don't have to try to grow.
That's right. Come on. Amen. Amen.
You just have to let the Spirit do its work inside of you.
Amen.
And when we grow, when we receive a Spirit and we grow, we automatically bear fruit. And those of you into agriculture, and I didn't have a good picture of it, but let me try. You know, this is the best. You know, you think about when a fruit grows, then it now seeds fall off of the fruit back into the ground, and it now goes in and another plant begins to grow.
That's right.
And so what God is saying, that when you grow and bear fruit, then even when your fruit now drops a seed, I'm still doing it. You begin to reduplicate yourself. So the secret to now to church growth is not in trying to go out and get a lot of people. The secret to church growth is for believers to be filled with Holy Ghost power, and then you will naturally bear fruit for Jesus. Oh, y'all not with me today? Oh, y'all not with me today? Huh? It's not in some methodology. It's not in some strategy. It's believing and receiving the life of Jesus inside of our hearts. And when that begins to happen, then believers can live and witness. You see, when you're at your job and you're just so filled with joy and love and everybody else is mad that they're at work, they're wondering, why are you so happy? It's because Jesus is living inside of your heart, and they want to know why you're so happy. Oh, y'all not with me today? Huh? So we got a whole bunch of believers not experiencing the life of Christ. They're keeping all the rules, but they don't know Jesus. Oh, y'all not with me today? And when Christ's power is released, then people like Gandhi can't say what he has to say. They can't say it's a bunch of hypocrites in there. Because when they come in encounter with us, when they come in contact with us, they see something different. They see the character of Jesus Christ. You see, God's power is released in our hearts, and that will cause us to grow, to bear fruit. And God is responsible for the entire process. Because we have believed and accepted in the word of Christ that has been sown in our hearts, the Spirit then enables us to live a holy life. In other words, the Spirit works in us to have a genuine Christian experience. He changes how we live. He enables us to walk worthy. You see, and I want to say to the person that believes that I can accept Christ but still be living in my sin. No. There's some believer, well, I love Jesus and Jesus knows my heart. But let me tell you something. Jesus, if you knew Jesus, then he would clean up your filthy heart. Oh, y'all not with me today? The evidence that Jesus' power is moving on the heart is a transformed life.
That's right.
Jesus wants to come in and he wants to release his power. Jesus changes the way you walk.
Yes, he does. Yes,
the way you live. He changes your desires, your appetite, the things you want to watch, the people you want to hang out with. He changes everything. And the truth, we down to ourselves, we cannot change our hearts ourselves. No, we can clean up the outside of the cup. Huh? But the inside is still dirty. Huh? Some of us, we were at South Suburban. My colleague, it was a wonderful illustration about a cup. He pulled up a cup and he said, how many people want to drink out of this cup? Let me use it. I'm going to use it right now. How many people wouldn't mind drinking out of this glass? You know it's clean, right? Huh? But if I put this glass in this dirty, in this dirt, in this flour, and put it up, how many people would want to eat out of this cup now, drink out of this cup now? Not anybody. But let's say I cleaned up the outside of the cup, but the inside was still dirty. Would you still want to drink inside of this cup? No. And so you can clean the outside and be good, but inside be still dirty. And so Jesus just doesn't want to clean the outside. He want to get in on the inside of the cup. At the heart of motivation. Why you do what you do. God wants to get rid of that stuff. Oh, y'all not with me today. Huh? You want to be free? You want to live for God? Let him come in your heart so he can do his work. Stop trying to do it yourself. Just receive God into your heart and he will cause you to live a whole new life. You will begin to walk worthy for him. Are y'all with me? Walk worthy. To walk is to conduct one's life in a manner that corresponds with the pure and righteous God we now serve as revealed in his word. So he's saying you have to now begin, after all that God has done, you have to now begin to walk and live a certain way. Conduct yourselves according to my word. How we live is proof that our experience with Christ is genuine. He says in Ephesians 2 verse 10, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Now, it is interesting in this book, it's when he goes to chapter 4 through 6, there are five therefores. So everything is predicated. The first therefore is walk worthy with each other in the church, unity, and we're about to get to that. But then he says, no longer walk as Gentiles in their darkened minds who don't know God. He says, therefore, don't walk like this anymore. Therefore, put away lying. Some of us, we've been Christian for years, but we still tell a lie. We still lying on people all the time. He says, therefore, be imitators of God. He says, and walk in love. Then he says, therefore, do not be unwise. And then he even goes down to dealing with our relationships with our wives. So we see in the book of Ephesians, there's nothing that God doesn't deal with. He deals with the church. He deals with the cosmic forces. He deals with the household. And he deals with the individual. He deals with each and every one of us in our lives. And as we go through Ephesians, we're going to get to some of the rest of the therefores and see what God is seeking to tell to us. But today, we want to go to what Jesus begins with first. Unity in the church. He says, therefore, walk in unity. Huh? And so the power at work in us causes us to walk in. I wonder, when I was studying this, I was like, of all the therefores he could have started with, he started with unity in the church. Huh? Oh, y'all not with me today. Huh? He could have started anywhere. But with the first therefore, he dealt with the relationship between believers in the church. That's how important unity is to Jesus. Oh, y'all not with me. It's going to get real quiet now. And why is this so important? You got to understand something. Remember, in the book of Ephesians, we have the Jews and the Gentiles. And they're discriminating against even being able to worship in the same place. That they don't have equal access to God. And it's because of their culture. And so remember, I preach a sermon, that Christ now tore down the dividing wall, which was actually a physical wall that separated the Jews from the Gentiles. All right? So in order for this to happen, Jesus had to die. Oh, y'all not with me there. Y'all want that to sink in for a second.
Yes, sir.
In order for there to be unity in the church, Jesus thought it was so important that he died on the cross. The division between us and God was so important, so paramount, that he died. And let me tell you something. The cross, he died to remove all division among believers. And he says, and let me tell you something. The cross now, the cross judges all things and reveals what God values the most. Hear me now. All the values in the world must be laid at the feet of the cross of Calvary. Because Calvary judges all values. It's interesting, I heard a preacher say, he says that because of what Christ has done, that there is no such thing as irreconcilable differences. Not for the believer in Christ. There is no relationship that cannot be repaired. Not if Christ's power has been released inside your heart. Because that's why he died. No irreconcilable differences. And hear me now. To celebrate culture or to hold up or hold on to our differences is to work against what Christ has accomplished. Huh? When you want to celebrate what divides us, it's like building up the wall again. It's like putting back the bricks and the mortar and saying, Christ, you didn't even have to die. You wasted your time. We're working against Jesus Christ. And really what we want to do, the real reason why we don't want to put aside our differences is because of our pride. Our pride of our position and our opinion and what we think about it. We want to idolize our story. Hear me now. We want to hold on to our story instead of God's story. And so the reason now, so we hold on. So we want to celebrate what God has torn down. And we don't understand that when we celebrate and perpetuate differences and refuse to bring an end to disputes among believers, we are hindering the work of Jesus Christ. That's how serious it is. That's how serious unity in church is. And some of us, we don't want to let go of our story because our story is so good. I got to talk about my accomplishments. I got to give all of the historical perspective on what happened. But that's not the most important story. God's story.
That's right.
Unity in the church. And he says, and this is it's also important, not only did Christ die, but he says in Ephesians 3, verse 10, he says that now the manifold wisdom of God might be made known by the church to the principalities and powers in heavenly places. So unity in the church is not just important to us and people living in this world, but Satan and fallen demons, when they see unity in the church, they know that their day is coming. Yes. Oh, you're not with me today? God is going to get rid of all disunity in the galaxy. He's going to put an end to Satan and his demons and his seeds of discord. And so the church, now hear me, becomes a visible, a tangible representation of what Christ has accomplished. We are to model what Jesus has done on the cross of Calvary. That's why it's so important. Because we're not only a witness to each other and to the people in this world, but we become a witness to even unseen worlds. And ultimately, unity is the evidence that God's influence is working on the heart of the person. If there is no unity, if you have no desire for unity, it means that something is amiss. Walking in unity, we're almost done here. He says, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you to walk worthy of the calling with which you were called. Beseech, urge, to ask for something earnest. He says, I am begging you. I'm begging you to do this. In chapter 4, in 1 verse 18, he says, I want you to pray that your eyes will be open, that you would know the hope of your calling, the wisdom of God. But now he wants us to live the hope. He says, now you know the hope, but now I want you to live the reality of God in your life. And so he says, in order for this to happen, hear me now, this is what characterizes unity in a church. This is what must happen. He says, with all lowliness, gentleness, with long-suffering, bearing with one another in love. The word for loneliness, humility, all right? So he says, and really, when we think about it, this is all the fruit of the Holy Spirit. In order for there to be healing, believers must be humble.
Amen.
Hmm?
Amen.
And it says, the quality of seeing ourselves as small, but at the same time, recognizing the power and the ability of God. And really what he's saying, he's not saying seeing ourselves as insignificant people, but seeing ourselves as just dust in comparisons to who God is. We have nothing to boast about. We're just dust. But it doesn't mean that you have low self-esteem, but you recognize that although I'm just dust, that he has placed a treasure in this vessel of dust, bringing value to who I am. So being humble is being willing to recognize God's power, but not thinking more of ourselves than we ought to. He says, in order for unity to take place, there must be humble, humility. Then there must be gentleness, meekness. Another word, attitude that expresses itself in patient submissiveness to offense. Hear me now. Patient submissiveness to offense. So when somebody's raking you over the coal and they're talking about you at your job and they're frowning at you when they see you, they won't talk to you. He says that you need to be gentle. Gentle is what allows you to weather those type of encounters. Free from malice and the desire for revenge. So you may not confront the person. You might smile, hey. But in your heart, there's malice. You wish you could just take him out back and give him a piece of your mind. And what is interesting about this is, if you know it, if you're not noticing already, is that even these characteristics, they're the work of the Holy Spirit. It's the fruit of the Spirit. But not only that, this is the very character of Jesus Christ. He says, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, because I am meek and lowly. I'm humble in heart. He says, in order for you to walk in unity, you must have my character.
Yes, Lord.
That's why Jesus could be on the cross and not have any desire for revenge.
Mercy.
Think about what they did to Jesus. And he didn't respond in one word of malice. And that's how Christ wants us to live. And he goes on and says, with all that is what is needed in order for you to be nurtured and fruit of the Spirit to be manifested in the church, with all lowliness and gentleness and long-suffering. In other words, for long-suffering is bearing, to hold oneself up against. In other words, to love even those who are hard to love. Now, when you think about this, can you do this by yourself?
No.
Come on now. You wake up in the morning like, okay, I'm going to love that person today. That person is getting on my nerves. I'm not going to let them get to me today. You can try all you want.
That's right.
We need a power working in us in order to have this type of character. Then he says, endeavoring to keep the unity in the Spirit and the bond of peace, endeavoring to do one's best. To hasten, the root is to use with speed, to make every effort. When there is disunity, make every effort. Run to the person to resolve it. Do your best. To be eager to do something with the implication of a readiness to expend energy and effort. So it means that you may come to them, but it might not be resolved. But you got to be willing to expend the energy and the effort that it will take to bring about the unity in the church. He says you have to do your best to maintain it. So Christ has done it, but it's our responsibility to allow his life in us to continue to try to hold on to it. He says, keep the unity, to guard it from loss. And this, my brothers, is the work of the Spirit. And what stands in the way of unity is not Christ, but us. It's us. Endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit of the bond of peace. The bond of peace, what keeps the unity is Christ. As we remain connected to Christ, we are able to be agents of peace. The bond of peace, Jesus ultimately in 2:14, he says that Christ is our peace. So in order to have peace, you have to have Christ. And as we remain connected to Jesus Christ, then we're able to be agents of peace. God's desire, we're getting ready to close. God's desire for his people is to live and work together in unity that flows out of Christ-like attitudes and a common core of beliefs. Amen. This is God's desire. Core beliefs that we all understand from the word in the light of Calvary. Amen. In the light of Jesus Christ. That is what must unify us, and a common attitude that is released in us when God's power is received in the heart of the believer. Unity is something the church already possesses. Hear me now. God has already done it. Our role is to nurture what he has already done and maintain it. And so for Paul, the first sign of growth in a believer is their ability to live with one another in a spirit of unity and love. And he says the basis for this, I'm getting ready to close, there is one body and one spirit, just as you were called in one hope of your calling, to one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God, one Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. Christ has made us all one. There is no division. And he is in us all. And when we can get together, we are denying his power that is at work in us. Ultimately, this is what God wants. In order to work worthy, we must be rooted and grounded in him. And the deeper our roots will be, the greater our fruit. And the more we will live for Jesus Christ. You want to be an authentic believer? Number one, hear his word, receive it, and allow his power to be released in your life and live by the power, by faith in his spirit, according to his word, what he has said for us. Amen? Amen. Who believes the word of the Lord today? Who believes this word today? Amen. I'm going to make just two appeals. And one, for the person here today that has never accepted Jesus Christ into your heart, and you want to receive him for the first time, you've heard the word today, you understand that his power, his life, is available to you in order to live a holy life in his name. And you want to receive the life of God. You want his power to be released inside of you so that you can walk worthy according to his will. If this is your desire today, I would invite you to slip out of your seat wherever you are, and come down to the altar and receive God into your heart so that his life, his power, can be released in your heart. The word is being planted. God is planting his word through the book of Ephesians. And God's word's ability to bear fruit in your life is whether you will receive it. Will you be humble? Or will you be hard-hearted? Anybody else here today want to receive Christ into your life today? A second appeal is this, and please, stand only if the Lord is telling you to stand. If it is your desire, amen, amen, my brother. Praise the Lord. Amen, my brother. God bless you, man. God bless you. Amen, amen. Let's have a seat over here. So amen.
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 Amen. Is anyone else here today? Anyone else here today? As we move into Ephesians, we're going to be getting into how to walk worthy. What is God? How to live a distinctly Christian life. Anybody else here today want to live for Jesus? He said he's able to do exceedingly, abundantly, what you ask or think according to the power at work in us. Anybody else here today want to receive that power? When you receive him into your life, there's nothing that God will not do to bring you into harmony with him. There's nothing Satan can do anymore. When you receive him, he has to let go. He has to release you. Because you have received the power of Jesus Christ in your life. He has no choice but to let you go. So today, if you want God's power to be released in your life, I want to invite you to stand wherever you are. Come down to the altar. And then my second appeal is this. If you want to stand, you can stand. My second appeal is this. You want to walk worthy in unity. And so you know that there's some tough things in your life. There's some broken pieces, broken relationships, whatever it is. But you know that God is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that you ask or think. And you want God to heal your relationships. I want to invite you to stand to your feet wherever you are. You want God to heal your relationships today. Invite you to stand. Then my third appeal. We see here that in order for us to have the character of Christ, we must receive the word of Christ. Amen. How many want to have his character? I don't know about you. I want to have his character.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And if this is your desire, you want to have Christ's character in your life today, I want to invite you to stand and we're going to pray for you. Standing for, if you want Christ's character, you want God to heal your relationships, and it's not too late if you want to give your heart to Jesus today. You've never given your heart to him. I want to invite you to come to the altar. We're praying, Father in heaven. Lord, we thank you for your word today. The word that you have given us so that we can know who you are, know what you have done, know what you're doing, know how you want us to live. Lord, we understand, oh God, that we're sinful, that we're prideful, that we're stubborn, that we're rebellious, that we're contentious, that we carry malice in our hearts. Lord, have mercy on us, oh God. Many of us, we have not been the Christians that you've called us to be. And so, Lord, we ask that you would forgive us and ask that you would fill us with your spirit. Lord, today we hear your word and we receive it. We accept it. We know it's true. And we want to have your character. And so, Lord, we pray that you would pour your character in us today. That we will be humble, gentle, and long-suffering. And, Lord, I pray for those who are standing, Lord, and desire for relationships to be healed that are broken. Your power cannot be fully manifested in our lives or in this church as long as the relationships are broken. Lord, heal us, oh God. Heal our relationships. And Lord, we pray for the young man that has come, and maybe there's somebody else that wants to come today. May he know that not only are you willing to save, but that you're able to save and that you have the power to save. Fill him with your spirit, oh God, in Jesus' name. Amen. Let everyone say amen.
Amen.
Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Amen.
Good afternoon, Straford. It is an honor and a privilege as someone who was baptized today to bring to Straford a new family member. Amen. He is my brother-in-law.
Amen.
He is the husband of my sister, Kia Essex, So let's welcome Wayne Clay to our family. He has come to us. He has come to us this today, not only for Bible study, but for baptismal.
Not our hearts burn.
Yes. Yes.
Kind of stand as we close. Before I close, I just like to read this. Given what Jesus had done for us, now is the time to humble our souls, search our hearts, put away all sins, and share the good news of salvation, warning a lost world. For we have been called by his grace and commissioned by his mercy.
Yes.
Please raise your right hand, repeat after me. May the Lord watch,
may the Lord watch
between me and thee,
while
we're absent, one from another.
This
we ask, in Jesus' name.
Amen.